In just a little bit, our children will come in waving their palms, and we will be singing, and they will be processing with the palms, and it is Palm Sunday, and it is great to welcome all of you here in the name of Christ. This is First Christian Church, Zanesville, Ohio, and I am Pastor Laureen Rowe, and it is Palm Sunday, the first day of Holy Week. I often refer to this as like the pregame to the Super Bowl, because we're going into Super Bowl week in the church here. It is a great day. I do welcome everyone here in the sanctuary and all of those who are worshiping with us online on this Palm Sunday. Want to remind you to fill out the registration slip that's on the edge of your bulletins or online. You can click the Google Form link, and online you can either click it now or after worship and fill that out so we have your information. I want to just take a moment and say something about these slips. This is a great place to let me and the office know things about you. I know that the temptation is to just tell me everything, and that's great, and I'm listening to you, and I'm right there with you in the moment, but there's a lot of you. And so I may not remember all the details come Monday. So you can tell me, but also write it down for me on that slip. And that way I will remember it more fully. Today we continue in our series of characters of Easter with Joseph of Arimathea. And we will learn all about Joseph in this morning's worship time. As I said, this is the first day of Holy Week. And we continue throughout the week with remembrances and worship as we journey with Jesus to the cross and then ultimately to his resurrection. This Thursday evening, we will have our Maundy Thursday worship. That is a Holy Thursday worship where we remember the Last Supper and Jesus' crucifixion. And then following that at 9 p.m., our Holy Week prayer vigil begins at 9 p.m. and goes through Friday at 6 p.m. There's still a few slots left on the prayer vigil sign-up sheet, so please fill those in and take a half hour to just be in prayer. Jesus gave himself for us. We can give half an hour of prayer for Jesus, so please sign up for that. And then next Sunday morning, we have grand Easter celebrations planned. We begin at 7 a.m. with our sunrise worship down the hill in the Spangler Memorial. There'll be a fire. Right, Rick? Where'd Rick go? He's over. I don't know where Rick is. There'll be a fire, though, I hear. There'll be a fire for his gathering because it's going to be a little chilly, according to the extended forecast. It's going to be a little chilly. So we'll have a fire to gather around, and we will read of the scriptures and share of communion and celebrate that Jesus is risen. Then at 8:30 and 10:30, we will worship and celebrate that Christ is risen. He is risen indeed right here in our sanctuary. These are all great events to invite your neighbors, your friends, your family members who may not be at church with you every week or those who are coming in from out of town. I think my children may actually be here next Sunday. And I'm going to embarrass her, but my sister's back there today. I'm so happy to have family here. That's Ellen. That's my sister Ellen. So it's exciting to have family with me today. With Mickey Sprague, our beloved custodian, out on medical leave for the next 6 to 8 weeks, we need some help around the church. There is a sign-up sheet out on the bulletin board for help. You know, this is something you don't have to do alone. Grab a crew and come in and do something around the church. The entry doors need cleaned every week, or, you know, run the vacuum cleaner in the sanctuary. Those things all seem to just magically get done when we have Mickey here, but he's not here right now. So we need some help. So if you would please sign up on that, we can take care of this holy ground that God has entrusted to us. Camp Christian registration forms for summer camp are due next Sunday to Kim, so please make sure if you're going to summer camp to get those forms in. I just want to do a special little shout out to any of you grandparents out there that want to take grandchildren. I think you should, because I'm going to be there. I'm going as a leader, so come join me at grandparent camp. And then on May 5th is the Big Brother Big Sister Bowl for Kids. We have four teams participating in the Bowl for Kids, so they need sponsors. So there's some kind of raffle. I don't understand it. Kim and the kids will help you understand if you go to their table after worship. But the teams, our four teams, are competing with each other to see who raises the most money. And then that team will get a trip to WITS. So support our kids. We have so much going on. I could talk for another half hour, but this isn't what we're here for. We're here to worship God. So please look at your bulletin and pay special attention to Earth Stewardship Sunday. On Mother's Day, we are doing a special Church World Service blanket sale, and our rummage sale is coming up. So look at the details of those in your bulletin. Now, let us start our worship with our prelude.
Thank you. God is great indeed. I welcome each and every one of you and praise God that you're able to participate, whether you are in our in-person sanctuary or our online sanctuary. We welcome each and every one of you. I would ask that all who are able stand now for our call to worship. Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the
highest. Hosanna! Blessed is the coming reign of God.
Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in humility and righteousness.
Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna! Save us, O God, and fill our heart in this time of worship. You know what's coming next. We get to have a poem parade, and we need music for our kids to process with. So let us all join joyously in We Are Walking in the Light of God. If you'll join me now in prayer together with our invocation. I know we all got excited, but we're going to move on with our collective prayer. Please join me. Majestic Lord, The radiance of your royal presence gleams brightly against the gathering shadows of the holy week to come. Open us to the mystery of your majesty, at once humble and exalted, suffering yet invincible. Grant us your spirit that we may learn to bend with grace and to rise triumphant in you. Amen.
You may be seated. Our first scripture is the account of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, found in the Gospel of Matthew. Hear these words of the Lord. When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, and on the foal of a donkey.'" The disciple went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the word of life.
I would like to invite all our children to come forward for our moment. Thank you for walking and waving palms if you did that. That helped bring God's joy into our worship. We were waving palms to remember that Jesus went into Jerusalem and everyone was cheering his name and shouting Hosanna. But later in the week, you know, Jesus was killed and they put him in a tomb. So today I brought with me like a small version of what it was his tomb, and then they rolled a very large rock in front of it. It would be a big, yeah, we have some rocks over there. No, I think, but there was a man named Joseph of Arimathea, and he's the man who owned the tomb that they put Jesus in, and he asked if Jesus could be put in his tomb. What do you think? Is that something you would give? No? What would you give to Jesus? A house. That's a much better place for Jesus, isn't it? Well, God thought the same thing. Easter morning, that stone was rolled away and it was empty and Jesus wasn't in there. But today we remember the stone and the tomb given to Jesus by Joseph of Arimathea. Joseph of Arimathea, because that's a big word. He gave a great gift. And that's what we're asked to do, no matter what time it is in life. Whether it's a time of waving palms and celebrating, or whether it's a time for a funeral, we are to give to Jesus and to God. Let us pray. You and your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask that you pour your blessings over each of them and over all the children of your world. We pray this in his holy name. Amen. All right, those of you who are going to Children, Worship, and Wonder, you can go over there with Kim. Those of you who are staying in worship, there are worship bags for you. If you've been with us ever since I came, you have noticed that every week I need to prop my iPad up on something because of the glare of the lights. Well, Marcy and Cato Coleman said she shouldn't have to prop up on something, and so they found something, doctored it up a little bit, and I now have a nice little stand, so... yeah, it works so well. So it was very nice of them to notice that and figure out a solution. This is a loving congregation who looks out for one another and notices where there is need and fulfills. As we come to our time of prayer, I know that's how you come, anticipating how you can pray for one another and fulfill the needs of one another. This week, we pray and keep in our hearts the family and friends of Bob Payne, and I know they are here today. We had his funeral here on Thursday, and we continue to carry you in our hearts and prayer in these days. We also lift up the family and friends of Margaret Johnson, that's Janice Fox's mother. Her funeral was on Friday, and we have received word that Harry West has begun his eternal life, so all of his family and friends are in our prayers as well. His funeral is tomorrow. And Barb Sly, who has been on our prayer list for a number of weeks, she began her eternal life yesterday. Maxine Rice and her daughter Jackie are dealing with COVID. Maxine has been in and out of the hospital several times, so we need to keep them in our prayers. We continue to keep Mickey Sprague in our prayers, Jean Davison, Penny Higgins, Bob Benarzik, and Brian Cooper. Let us go to our Lord as one in Christ. Holy God, no day is a better day as a reminder of our fickle nature than today. Our shouts of hosannas, our joy that bursts as Jesus comes into Jerusalem as King, changes and shifts as the world changes and shifts. And then he is crucified. As we go through this week, hold us accountable to walk with Jesus faithfully, not only through the good times, but through the hard times as well. Lord, we lift into your arms all those who are grieving, and we ask that you care for them, that you wrap your spirit around them and hold them close to your heart. And Lord, Please be with those whose lives have been caught up in division, in conflict, and disagreement. Sow seeds of harmony and peace in their lives. Lord, there are so many in our world that are ravaged by cancer, by COVID, by so many other illnesses and disease. Pour your healing spirit over each as they have need, and allow us to see your healing at work. Keep your hand on medical professionals. Use them as your instruments, and allow your care to flow through each. Lord God, we continue to fret and worry and be dismayed at the war that is going on in our world. All over the world, there are pockets of violence where lives are senselessly lost, where bombs are going off near children and families. Lord, grab a hold of us. Grab a hold of us and fill us with a peace that passes all understanding so we can see your eyes in the eyes of all others. Lord, we come to you with hope. Hope that comes only through your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us that there is a way, that you are the truth and the life. Hear us as we pray the prayer that he taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we come to our time of sharing, I want to remind you that we are taking up our Easter offering with 50% of it going to the Operation Feed, Muskingum County Hunger Network, and 50% of it going to Camp Christian's operating budget. Today is Palm Sunday, and we are shouting, Hosanna!
Hosanna!
Hosanna in the highest!
Hosanna in the highest!
Jesus entered Jerusalem, and the people were waving their palms, and they were laying their cloaks on the ground as they shouted their Hosanna!
Hosanna!
That's what they had to offer. That's what sprung from their spirits. And then their cheers and what they gave fell apart as the week progressed. What do we offer on this Palm Sunday? Do our tithes and offerings that we offer today have staying power? I believe they do. I believe that that's the miracle of the church, that what we give, when it's combined together, all of our offerings, and then it's mixed up with the Holy Spirit, the mystery of God happens. So as we wave our palms and we shout our
Hosanna,
you guys are awesome, let us bring our tithes and our offerings and let's watch as the mystery of God unfolds right before us. Let us pray.
Almighty God, we recognize the abundance of gifts you lavish on us, including the salvation Jesus provided and is given to us each and every day. We give our offering back to you and extend our help and hand to others who might need a share of our gifts from you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. My name is Joseph, and I come from the little town of Arimathea. I'm a wealthy man and a member of the Sanhedrin. That's a body of 70 men who are in charge of Israel's spiritual life. Our main task is to decide what is and what is not the law. We have thousands of written and oral laws that all Jews are expected to obey. It takes me a long time to make up my mind. It has always been hard for me to take sides. At this time, we have many arguing factions. We're usually a group of decent fellows, but our good name went down in one fell swoop in the year of 33 AD. For a long time, prophet sent by God. The regret of my life is I didn't speak more forcibly when the Sanhedrin met before dawn on a Friday morning. I did, along with Nicodemus, vote no. Speaking up for Jesus wouldn't have changed their minds, but it surely would have made me feel better. During the time of the crucifixion, I sat with Nicodemus, watching Jesus die. Both of us were in shock over the shabby treatment Jesus had received at the hands of the Sanhedrin. The leaders of our group wanted to get rid of Jesus, I said, because he was so popular. They can't stand it that people listened more to Jesus than to them. Both Pilate and Herod would have turned Jesus loose, said Nicodemus. If he hadn't come to Jerusalem, I said, none of this would have happened. Jesus would still be in Galilee preaching to the masses and healing them. Nicodemus added, we've waited too late. Early on in his ministry, he and I had a special talk. Even then, I was a coward. I visited him at night, not wanting anyone else to know. There is one thing, only one thing I can do now, I said, and that is to see that he has a tomb for his burial. I have one nearby. I'm going to ask Pilate for permission to bury him. That's a good idea, said Nicodemus. I'll provide the shroud for his tomb cloths and 75 pounds of spices. Joseph, I'll go with you to see Pilate. I'd like him to know that Jesus did have some friends among the Sanhedrin. We received Pilate's permission to bury Jesus and return to Golgotha. After Jesus exclaimed, "It is finished," he ceased breathing. A soldier pierced his side, his cross was lowered, and the nails removed. We took the body of Jesus to my garden tomb. We were followed by a group of women shackled by fear and grief. The women watched as Nicodemus and I wrapped his body in long linen strips like bandages. The last thing we did was roll a circular stone in the groove in front of the tomb. As we turned to leave, Nicodemus and I embraced. For some time, we stood there, sobbing out our hearts. Too late, I said. If only I had defended him before the council. I knew he was innocent, and yet I said nothing. Nicodemus wiped the tears from his cheeks. I should have thrown caution to the wind. I don't know why I feel this way, Joseph. But somehow I feel that Jesus is giving you and I a second chance. We can't change yesterday, but we can change today. When this nightmare passes, I suspect Jesus will still be around.
Joseph of Arimathea, for sharing his story with us. We have spent the last several weeks exploring the characters of Easter. We were with Judas and the high priests when Judas sold out Jesus for 30 silver coins. And then Caiaphas and Pilate, washed his hands and blood be on the mob. Peter, who denied Jesus 3 times before the cock crowed. The mob who shouted, "Crucify him, crucify him." And Jesus in the garden before he's arrested. And today we meet Joseph of Arimathea, who gave his tomb for Jesus. Before we explore Joseph of Arimathea in depth, I think it's important for us as Christians in this Holy Week to look at the story as a whole and remember that the week began with fanfare as Jesus entered into Jerusalem and where we end up at the end of the week. All 4 of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, all tell the story of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. All 4 report that Jesus came in as a king and that a great multitude of people were in position to welcome him and were cheering and chanting. But the words he chose, the manner he arranged, were they truly fit for a king, for the Son of God? As he rode through the streets on a lowly donkey? Is that what we expect? We are told in the scriptures that Jesus rides into Jerusalem on a donkey in order to fulfill the prophecy. The prophet Zechariah writes, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey." We heard Alaina read this in our first text earlier. So the disciples are fulfilling the prophecy when they bring the donkey and the colt, they place their cloaks on them, and Jesus sits on them and rides into Jerusalem. And the many people around spread their cloaks on the road while others wave their palms in the air and shout, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." All of this happening was very reminiscent of the jubilant royal entrances and processions of Solomon. And we read about these in 1 Kings. King David said, "Summon to me the priest Zadok, the prophet Nathan, and Benaniah, son of Jehoiada." When they came before the king said to them, "Take with you the servants of your Lord and have my son Solomon ride on my mule and bring him down to Gihon." There they let the priest Zadok and the prophet Nathan anoint him king over Israel and blow the trumpet and say, "Long live Solomon! You shall go up following him. Let him enter and sit on my throne. He shall be king in my place, for I have appointed him to be ruler over Israel and over Judah." The Jews were looking for a king like this, a king that was in the line of David. So Jesus entered Jerusalem. They celebrated him as such a king. Caiaphas and the chief priests would have recognized these signs and been angered by this alone. But then Jesus goes into the temple. And there were a lot of places he could have gone, but he chooses to go into the temple. And when he does, he begins overturning the tables, driving out those who bought and sold in the temple, all of the money changers, and those who sold for sacrifices. Why is this happening? Why does this go on? Why does Jesus do this? People had traveled long distances for the Passover, and the people would be coming to the temple to make their sacrifices. But for many people, it was very impractical to travel with the necessary animals for the sacrifices that needed to be made. So there in the temple were merchants who set up to sell such animals for sacrifices. But when Jesus enters the temple, he discovers that the merchants were price gouging and taking advantage of God's people. So Jesus gets mad and he starts overturning the tables and he says, "It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." Following this, Jesus then begins to heal all of those who are coming to him for healing. And the scriptures say, "But when the chief priests and the scribes saw the amazing things that he did and heard the children crying out in the temple, 'Hosanna to the Son of David,' they became angry. And they said to him, 'Do you hear what these are saying?' And Jesus said to them, 'Yes. Have you never read, out of the mouths of infants and nursing babies, you have prepared praise for yourself?' It is from here that they then began to put together a plan to arrest Jesus. Now, while the priests are all caught up in planning to put an end to Jesus, Jesus continues doing what Jesus does best. He teaches and he heals. The scriptures leading to the cross are filled with parables and teachings of the coming kingdom. Then on the Thursday night, all that Jesus had been teaching about him dying began to unfold. Jesus and his disciples secretly met in an upper room within the city limits for their Passover feast, their Last Supper. And here Jesus is betrayed by Judas, who'd sold him out for 30 pieces of silver. Jesus left the upper room with the other disciples and went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. The disciples could not stay awake while Jesus went to pray. And Matthew writes, this is what Jesus prayed: "My Father, is it possible, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." It is then in the garden following his prayer that Judas comes, kisses Jesus as a signal, and Jesus is then arrested and carried away by the temple guards and Roman soldiers. The disciples scatter. Peter denies knowing Jesus. And throughout the night and following morning, Jesus is sent from one ruler to another to decide what should be done with him. The high priest Caiaphas does not have authority to condemn him to death. So Caiaphas takes him to Pontius Pilate. And as we explored a few weeks ago, Pilate was hesitant to condemn Jesus to death, but eventually was forced to give in when the crowd insisted. And the Jewish leaders reminded him that Jesus' claim to be king was a challenge to Roman authority. Pilate could have stopped this madness, but prophecy would not have been fulfilled. Pontius Pilate's own wife, who later became a believer herself, tried to warn him, but he didn't listen, and he did what the crowd wanted. And only a little while later, after terrible beatings and floggings, Jesus was led to Golgotha, where he would be crucified. Jesus was nailed to the cross and taunted. And scripture reads, "From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?' That is, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, 'This man is calling for Elijah.' And at once one of them ran and got a sponge filled with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, 'Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him.' Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last." Jesus was dead. This is where Joseph of Arimathea comes in. And we hear of Joseph in our second scripture found in Luke 23, verses 50 through 56. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, though a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. So just who is Joseph of Arimathea? Joseph was a disciple of Jesus Christ when no one else wanted to be recognized as one of Jesus' disciples. But Joseph of Arimathea is not one we typically think about when we mention Jesus' disciples. But all the others were trembling in fear, hiding from Roman authorities. And here is Joseph of Arimathea boldly asking Pilate for Jesus' body. In this moment, that's what a disciple looks like. How many of us would have the courage to do as Joseph of Arimathea and go against all of those that we called friends and family? Joseph of Arimathea is one of the few who is mentioned in all four of the Gospels. The Gospels of Matthew and John refer to Joseph as a disciple of Jesus. The Gospels of Mark and Luke note that Joseph of Arimathea is a member of the council. This is the Sanhedrin council, which was made up of the high priest, all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes. They were the ones who voted to have Jesus arrested. This was the group present as Caiaphas, the high priest, questioned Jesus. And our text tells us, though, Joseph was a good and righteous man who, though a member of council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. And now, Joseph of Arimathea wanted to make sure that Jesus received the burial he deserved, one of a rich man. This was to fulfill the prophecy. In the midst of the prophet Isaiah's suffering servant text, we hear these words: "They made his tomb with the rich." Being one of the council, when Joseph of Arimathea asks for Jesus' body, Pilate could have gotten really angry. "Well, wait a minute, first you want me to crucify him, and now you want his body?" But that's not what happens. After Jesus dies, Joseph goes to Pilate and asks for his body, and Pilate grants his request. I think God's at work here. Then Joseph of Arimathea takes Jesus' body down from the cross and carries it to his tomb. The tomb where Joseph buried Jesus was his own tomb. Only the rich had tombs carved out of the caves. The poor would be buried in shallow graves with no markers, no inscriptions anywhere to indicate who was buried there. And this is most likely what would have happened to Jesus had Joseph not gone and asked for Jesus' body. There was a call on Joseph's heart that he followed. Joseph had money, and Joseph had his own brand new tomb. All the wealthier people did in those days. They expanded caves. They dug into the gray limestone. They made shelves within the caves to hold the bodies of the dead. Now, the very rich carved into the limestone hills and built enough shelves that entire generations upon generations could be kept in one tomb. These tombs were sealed with a round stone. Each wheel fit into a groove in the track that was built on the side of the cave, and the stone was rolled up the track and then wedged in place by a smaller stone. And once the body was taken into the tomb, the smaller stone was removed and the wheel of rock rolled down the track, sealing the tomb. We know this is the type of tomb Jesus was placed in because later scripture tells us that when the women arrived on that first Easter morning, the stone was rolled away. The tombs of this nature had shelves in the walls, as I mentioned, and Jesus' body was the only body in there. There were not generations upon generations. It was a new tomb. Scripture makes a point of telling us that. No other bodies were there, leaving no room for confusion on Easter morning. The tomb was empty before Jesus' body was placed in there, and the tomb was empty on Sunday morning. The only resident in between, Jesus' body was not there on Sunday morning. Get that clear. The tomb was empty on Sunday morning, and the only body in between the two was Jesus. Joseph of Arimathea was a faithful disciple, and he's one that most overlook, but one who played a very pivotal role for God's plan of salvation. Joseph of Arimathea, a faithful disciple. You, too, are a faithful disciple. You follow as faithfully as you can, one step at a time. We have walked through Lent with many of the key figures who shaped the outcome of the week. And here we are on the first day of Holy Week. And as we walk, I want to encourage you to remember Judas, the high priests, Caiaphas, Pilate, Peter, the mob, Jesus in the garden, and Joseph of Arimathea. Who is it that you identify with most closely? Maybe it's one of them. Maybe it's a couple of them. Maybe it's all of them. And maybe it's at different times and circumstances of your life you identify with one or the other. I encourage you this week, this Holy Week, to take a moment or two each day, reflect, remember, and put yourself at the foot of the cross where Jesus is crucified, and then walk to the tomb with Joseph of Arimathea. And join us next Sunday when we remember and celebrate Christ's resurrection. Let us pray. Lord God, on this Palm Sunday, on this first day of the holiest week of the year, we come to you and we put ourselves before you as faithful disciples, and we ask that you walk with us each faithful step this week. Give us courage to follow Jesus each day, each moment, as he walks to his death. Show us how to be your faithful disciples in this world of yours and to reflect the joy that comes. We pray this all in your Son's holy name. Amen. If God has been at work in your life and you want to follow Jesus and you've never made that confession of faith, I want to invite you to come forward as we sing. Or if you want to transfer your membership into the life of this congregation or rededicate your faith, please come forward as we stand and sing, "My Jesus, I Love Thee."
Oh,
be seated. No matter where we are in the journey, no matter what's going on, whether we find ourselves a faithful disciple like Joseph of Arimathea, or we're in the midst of a step as being more like Judas, we are welcomed at this table. All of God's children are welcomed at this table. So let us prepare to receive this great gift by singing together, "Break Thou the Bread of Life."
Hearing our prayers and nourishing us with the body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ our Lord. Help us to prepare our hearts as we receive the bread and cup, two beautiful symbols of Christ's body broken for us and his precious blood shed for us. We bow in honor before you in grateful remembrance of your great sacrifice for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We will partake of the bread following the words for the bread, and we will drink of the cup following the words for the cup. Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread and he blessed it, and then he broke it and he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." And then he took a cup, and after giving thanks for it, he said, "This is my blood, which is shed for each of you. Take and drink in remembrance of me." Amen. I want to invite you all to now stand and let us sing together a favorite of many, "How Great Thou Art."
Consider all the
Lord God, as we step out of this place and into your world, walk with us as we faithfully walk with Jesus toward the cross, and show us how to be your church. Amen.